what is the height of this lamppost? Most people reply 4 meters, but there is a little problem with that answer. Like all measurements, measuring length requires units, which we must agree upon before measurement. If I rocked up to the lamppost measuring convention with my special half-length meter stick, the lamppost would be 8 meters. Somehow that doesn't feel right. Shouldn't the lamppost's height be, in some way, part of the lamppost? It shouldn't depend on an external definition. Is there a better definition of height which is independent of the units used to measure it? Can we actually capture the essence of height using mathematics? That's what I want to talk about today. To be more specific than that poorly written hook, height refers to an intrinsic or local property of that lamppost. No matter what I do away from the lamppost, its height should remain unchanged or invariant. As the meter stick used to measure height isn't part of the lamppost, swapping it out shouldn't change the lamppost's height. That's what I mean when I say it feels wrong for its height to double if I were to halve the definition of a meter. I haven't touched the lamppost, so why does its height change? Can we create a better mathematical object which takes the units into account? What we want is a mathematical object which tries to resist the unit change. We want it so that when the unit length halves, the measured value doubles in reaction, and so on. No matter what the arbitrary unit everyone uses to measure the lamppost, if everyone uses this mathematical object, then its height should be agreed upon. This object is called a contravariant tensor. It's a tensor because it reacts to a change in units, and it is contravariant as it varies in contrast to the change in units. Frequency can be described as a tensor as well, but unlike length, frequency is covariant. Doubling the unit doubles the measurement, varying in cooperation. A frequency of once per second is equal to 60 times per minute. By having measurements transform with the units, or more generally, the coordinates of the observer, tensors are able to preserve the essence of a physical property between observers. Now that we have a definition of an object which preserves the physics between transformations, what else can we do? Changing units is only one kind of coordinate transformation. So, can we generalize our definition? In mathematics, coordinate transformations are done using a Jacobian matrix, made by taking partial derivatives of one coordinate system to the other. This allows the definition of tensors to be written as such. Wielding a mathematically robust definition, let's take a swing at a difficult problem. Say we are using radar to measure the lamp's height from a distance. This forces us to use polar coordinates, which uses distance and angle as coordinates. The coordinate conversion is this, and calculating the Jacobian matrix gives us this. Pushing the tensor for height through, we can predict what the lamp post looks like on the radar, and vice versa. Think about what we just did. If we know the height in one coordinate system, we know its height in every other curvilinear coordinate system. Not only do tensors free us from units, but from coordinate choice entirely. Formally, the idea of physics being independent to the way we observe it, and hence the coordinates used, is background independence. As physics describes physical things, which don't care about how we observe them, I'm sure you can understand most equations in physics are actually tensor equations. Despite our current power of tensors, there is a large weakness in our current definition. Single coordinate transformations can only describe static objects. A moving object is essentially doing an infinite number of tiny transformations forward or backwards, and our tensor definition only really handles single transformations. The way to solve this is to include time itself as a coordinate. In spacetime, any object traveling through time draws out a path, or world line. A stationary object goes straight up, moving objects are slanted, and accelerating objects are curved. We are all stationary relative to ourselves, so by rotating the time axis so that the world line is vertical, we can see what the universe looks like from their perspective. Note that this rotation is called a Lorentz boost. For reasons I'll explore in another video on special relativity, Lorentz boosts increase both time and space component, leading to these rotations following hyperbolic curves instead of circles. The important part is that if we know how something acts under our observations, our equations immediately work for all other observers. No matter whether the other observer is moving, accelerating, using a telescope or kaleidoscope, our space-time tensor equation preserves the physics between them. To see a brilliant example, let's turn to electromagnetism. If you've watched any videos on physics, especially particle physics, you will have seen electricity and magnetism being referred to as the singular electromagnetism. Why is electromagnetism considered a single force? Why do we consider the electric field and magnetic field to be of one object? Let us start by reviewing what they are individually. A static charge produces an electric field. A moving charge creates a magnetic field as well. Electric fields were well known to be created by magnetic fields, but only with Maxwell did we realize the same works in reverse. This is all summed up in the four Maxwell-Heaviside equations. Even if you haven't learned them before, these four differential equations are pivotal to our understanding of the world, describing photons, capacitors, and much more. Okay, so even with the history lesson, we still haven't answered the question. Why do we call it electromagnetism? Maxwell's equations state how the electric and magnetic field interact with each other, but nowhere does it explicitly treat them as the same thing. Maxwell had his own reasoning to why he unified them, but we can understand it ourselves using tensors. As a magnetic field only appears when a charge is moving, something moving with the charge doesn't see it. This means magnetism is observer-dependent. Unlike height, magnetism isn't itself a local property. It turns out by mixing the electric and magnetic potentials together in space-time, all four equations are special cases of this tensor equation under Lorentz gauge. By treating magnetism as a physical property by forcing it into a tensor equation, we find it impossible to do so without putting electricity on equal footing. The electric four potential, as it's called, is only constructible by unifying the two together. By the simple requirement that the two fields require each other to form a tensor, only electromagnetism as a whole has physical significance. The simple requirement that physics doesn't care about exactly how we see things necessitates tensor equations across all fields of mechanics. I find it a little disheartening knowing that I only encountered the magic of tensors so late in my studies. Obvious relations were previously far flung without the framework of tensors to consider them with. Even without a rigorous deep dive, I hope this video sheds the mysteries behind the ubiquity of tensors in physics, putting an end to the previous explanation of a tensor transforms like a tensor. This video is for 3 Blue 1 Browns Summer Contest, where you can submit videos teaching mathematical concepts before the deadline on August 22nd. As I only had one submission, I decided to tell a much denser narrative than my previous videos, just so I could put everything I wanted to discuss about tensors into one video. If you feel a bit lost, don't fret. I made a video after all. Feel free to re-watch it and ask questions in the comments. Have a good evening.